I had prepared my speech with good morning in it, but then we have, it's 12. So thank you for joining us for the inaugural lecture of the EFLU lecture series in Japanese studies. 2018-19 is an important year for all of us here at the English and Foreign Languages University, as we are celebrating 60 years of the university's establishment, what we call as the Diamond Jubilee celebrations. This year is also important for the department as well, because this marks 2018-19 marks the 25th year of Japanese language courses introduced in EFLU. So the EFLU lecture series in Japanese studies, through this lecture series we aim to invite eminent personalities from fields as diverse as area studies, Japanese language education, and in the areas of diplomacy when it comes to Indo-Japan relations. Today we have with us Professor Ashok Chawla Sensei. We are used to calling him as Chawla Sensei. This is the first time, in fact, I'm calling you as Professor Ashok Kumar Chawla and not Chawla Sensei, as we all have called you, I think, during our university years. Now, Japan has sort of told us that India is its cornerstone when it comes to its relations with countries in Asia, and India also places Japan as a key a player when it comes to its Look East Asia policy. So we are, in fact, this is a very great opportunity for us to attend this lecture with one of the key people involved in the Indo-Japan relations. Professor Ashok Kumar Chawla is the key person involved in the Indo-Japan relations, and as part of this, he is the interpreter for the Prime Minister and as well as other top dignitaries in this in the diplomatic relations between India and Japan. But before his role here in the Ministry of External Affairs, he has taught for more than two decades as a visiting faculty at the Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi, and is now the visiting faculty at Ritsumeikan Asia Pacific University. Apart from this, his profile is quite lengthy. I'm cutting it short. Apart from this, he was also the chief scientist working with a government organization where he has been involved in translation as well as machine-aided translation, as well as training interpreters and translators. So I would like all of you to help me in inviting Professor Ashok Kumar Chawla to the stage. Professor Ashok Kumar.
Good afternoon to all of you. Most of the faces I was just talking to a while ago, and few faces here have been with me decades ago. First of all, thank you so much for inviting me, and it's always a privilege to talk to the students, to talk to the academia. The inaugural lecture of EFLU's this particular center is very important for me, both in terms of my current assignment as well as the previous assignment. In general, I have been a teacher, a translator, and then teaching translation and interpretation. I just told that I used to work in my previous organization as was called technocrat, because I was doing the management. It was a scientific job, so it's technocrat. And for last about 3 years now, 2.5 years, I'm working in Ministry of External Affairs as diplomat. Just recalled your Diamond Jubilee celebrations. It was few years back, about 10 years back, we had Diamond Jubilee celebrations at NISCARE in my office, and we tried to collaborate with EFLU. in those days, I was given the charge of media center, developing the media center, and you have a wonderful media center here. Then there was a person called Professor Ram, probably, who was in Russian and wanted to translate books. And we wanted to translate the scientific high-level books from Russian to English and other Indian languages. This was a big project which I started to do as a technocrat, failed in pushing the project. I attempted approximately 20 projects during my 40 years, out of which I am able to take forward approximately 4 or 5 projects only. So the strike rate, you can say, or success rate, you can say, is this much only. I'm telling this to my former dear students. They should not get disheartened if all students don't respond, if all the channels in the university don't respond. In fact, you also did not respond well when I used to say the things. So that's the game. That's how it works. You then picked up. I was just talking to Surya Kant. He took a chance. It can be called a second chance of life. There were many people who were not very supportive of that fact. I was supportive, but I in my heart had the feeling that probably he may not get what he had in his hand before coming to university back. This is part of life. I also took a chance before that, shifted from science to humanities, that is pure science. I was a genetics person, wanted to become a genetic scientist, not sure what it would have given me. The people who were with me are in US now doing very hi-fi scientific research. Probably I would have done something like that, not very sure. I was into vegetative area, so it was not very sure, because it all depends on various factors. But I'm very happy to be where I am today. As I told to the students a while ago, wanted to become a translator. The term which I knew at that point of time was communicator. To become a communicator between the two cultures, between the two different cultures. The reason was Japan, which was defeated by America. I didn't know to what extent in those days. Tokyo was completely wiped off. Some areas were completely black. So much bombing was done that the wheat which was coming or the rice which was coming was black color. This extent was not known to me, that so much damage was caused, but I knew that Hiroshima, Nagasaki, and some damage to Tokyo also. How can a society damaged so badly can revive or can come back in such a small time, in such a short duration? And then the product, I recall former Prime Minister Chandrasekhar speaking in one of his election speeches before he became the Prime Minister. He was called Young Turk. And I was young in those days, so I used to listen to the speeches. I went and I asked him a question. He spoke on Japan. And I asked him a question, how can you say that Japan is a great country? And then he says that 5 years back, the watch which he used to buy from, or which was made in Japan, it will last for a few months. But today, Japan produces the best. And that today was just 5 to 10 years. So how a society can bring in such a big change within a period of 5 to 10 years, this was the anxiety level to me at that point of time. I had seen some patents of Japan, Japanese, written in Japanese language, of course. Those patents were revealing. They were revealing that the type or the level of scientific research they have been doing is really of a different platform, a different level. Same we can call today probably for China. The number of patents they do, the type of the level of study they do is pretty different now. The level is very, very high. Now this difference of level, and I somehow did not have much interest in US. In those days people had interest. First country is US, next is England. Then you go to Australia, New Zealand, and then two other countries like Germany. Japan was probably after Germany in those days. And I picked up Japan because of that reason. Maybe because of liking for Japan for some other reason. Maybe you're bent towards some particular country. And reaching today's level, I find that it was not a mistake. As I was telling earlier also, that you decide what you want to do. You check it countercheck it, check it again 2-3 times, that do you really love it? Suppose you want to become a basket player, or you want to become a cricketer. Doesn't matter, you may not become Sachin Tendulkar or Virat Kohli or a, you know, very strong bowler. But do you, can you survive in that? That means, can you earn your bread? Number one, minimum, not the luxury, minimum. And number two, do you really enjoy that? If yes, then go for it. So for all of you who are the Japanese, I think mostly Japanese language students are here. There are other language people are there or no? No. So I can focus, if you pardon me, I'll probably use some Japanese examples more to make it more interesting to them. You know, it's always better, suppose you decide for Japanese language, and after 1 year you find that no, not really enjoying it. No harm in shifting to another language. Could be Chinese, could be French, could be any other, Indian language also. There is huge scope of work from Indian language to Indian language, or from Indian language to English. So no harm in doing so. Don't waste your time, but check and recheck. Discuss with your teachers, discuss with your elders, discuss with your peer group, and see if you are right or wrong. Do it rightly, but do it at the right time. Don't wait too long. Don't fall for one particular thing just for the sake of it. It should be something which you really love, which you really want to do. And as I said a while ago, I wanted to do only translation, not the language per se. That means not teaching language. I was invited to teach, so I was fortunate to teach some people. They learned and they become big. I'm more happy. That's fine. But primarily, I am a translator. Interpretation is extension of this. I'll speak a little bit about translation and graduating to interpretation also during the discussion. So let me go to the slide about the language first. The topic is India-Japan partnership or India-Japan relationship in today's world and its consequences or its impact through the language, or what language can do for this. You know, language education, we must remember, what is it basically? I don't know if you all remember that the language was taught very long ago, Shanti Niketan, Bharatiya Vidyapeeth, and so many other places. It's decades ago, 40, 50, 60, 70 years back also, language was taught. Our people had gone abroad, they knew English very well. Our people have gone to other countries also. They spoke those languages. This means language was taught. So there is an informal way of learning language, or there's a formal way of learning language. What you are doing here is a formal way of learning. First, see the informal way. The informal way is, it's a hobby. So you have any hobby animation. You want to learn Japanese animation. Somebody says, I want to do judo. Somebody's anxious. For example, I was anxious to know how a Japanese society who are Asians can be so different from Indians. Why are we so lazy? Why are we so not punctual? Why this element of dishonesty? And why is reverse in the case of Japanese? Is it really true what we hear about Japan? The punctuality, the honesty, the sincerity. Today I can say, quite true, not 100%. It's quite true. Quite true means it's, if you put it on a scale of 100, I would say more than 80% probably. Maybe 90%. As compared to, if we compare, we are on the lower side. Pretty lower side. So what makes it different? We are the two same race, Asians only. The human relationship is same, the religion is same, the family relationship is same. Then what is the difference? So this anxiety was there. So I become an informal learner of Japanese language. Sometimes it could be compulsion. Compulsion is that you have landed in Japan, or you are working in a Japanese society, or Japanese people around you, you need to speak in Japanese language. Or I fall in love with a girl who is Japanese, does not speak any English. There's no way. I will have to learn. If I love a girl from, say, Kerala, it takes hardly 1 week to learn Malayalam. No? I can't try probably, but there are people who can try. There are ways which, there are incentivized ways. And one incentivized way is the human relationship. The other is working with people in the industry, for example. When you work in the industry, you have a zeal to learn something, pick up new things. And the person who can teach you can teach only in that language. You have no way. you will ask, okay, okay, tell me what does this word mean? Even if you don't use the verbs properly, you'll be able to communicate. So this is the second compulsion. In my case, it was the first one, and I started learning Japanese, thinking about learning Japanese. And then I had to think, should I go into Japanese, making it a profession or making it a tool? And I decided to make it a tool. So it fell in the first category, and I learned Japanese language for 1 year. It was an intensive course, approximately 650 or 700 hours of teaching, because university teaching is approximately 100 to 150 days a year, per day 4 hours, so approximately 600 hours of teaching. Teaching was actually for 600 hours. There was no bunking. There is no late teacher coming or student coming late. 100% attendance. And then homework, so approximately 4 to 6 hours of homework and practice. So all put together about 10 hours. And as I told you that after that I could clear L1, the level reaches that level. And I started working, and after about 1 year, I am told by somebody who has been, for whom I have been interpreting, that 1 year back, we actually did not understand what you were speaking. Do you understand the meaning of this? There's a technical interpretation going on, and I am the interpreter. I interpret, and 1 year later, somebody tells me, a very senior person tells me, we did not understand even a word when he used to interpret. And I said, then what was happening then? Our guesswork, your interpretation, Indian English, plus our guesswork. It was so sad. I quit the job once again. This probably many didn't know. So I'm revealing this was another chance I gave to my life. I had money to survive for about a year or so at that point of time. But I quit the job and came to JNU to do my master's. And master's not from fourth year. I started learning once again. That was a big thing, spending so much time once again. And this time, it shifted from informal to formal. And this time, I had a very clear defined objective to become communicator, translator of scientific literature. The patent particularly, the high-tech documents, and other such information. This was very clear to me when I started studying. There could be part-time courses also, there could be regular courses also, and there's a specialization. Specialization means that you do part-time courses, for example, advanced diploma, something else, in total putting approximately 1,000 hours, clearing your N1, and maybe able to do interpretation and translation, as I call part-time courses. Regular course means you do BA in Japanese, then master's in Japanese, and then look for a job. And specialization is that you may do PhD or MPhil PhD, or you may specialize in a particular field, in the language itself. In the language means in the particles, in grammar, in conversation, in translation, in interpretation. It is the last one which I targeted. The journey is still on. I have learned something like, it appears to me, I'm not very sure, it appears to me something like 30 to 50% I have learned what is required for my profession. 20 to 30% I still guess, still risky, but I am guessing on the basis of 40-50% of understanding. I understand 40-50%, and as I told you, capture the structure. Structure is captured very clearly, and now I guess whenever there is a problem. But still there is an element which I don't understand, which I am not very clear whether I know or not. So there is a huge which is still to be learned. This is how I treat informal and formal. Interest can go from interest from formal to it's missing probably informal to formal. But once you have started journey from informal, it can become a formal. You, for example, I started informal and then shifted to formal, and then you can start thinking of becoming multilingual also. Multilingual means you already know Hindi, Telugu, English, and Japanese minimum. Being here in this state, you know these languages. There is a possibility that you may know Tamil also because of movies or because of your family or because of some other reason. So there is a possibility that you're, because of some reason, you may think of doing another language which could be German, totally different from Japanese. So becoming multilingual is also a possibility, but multilingual, remember, I have seen about many people say that he knows 18 languages, 5 languages, 10 languages, etc. But one cannot be an expert, a specialist in more than one language easily. Exceptions can be there. So please remember that multilingual means you will have one language which you are mastering, and other languages could be the side languages or the supportive languages. And then you can explore. You can explore the different areas. You want to become language person, or you want to go into some other area. What you can think of is teacher, becoming a teacher. This is most sought after job in India. Reason being that you have enough spare time to do what you want to do. Technically, you should do research and guide people, but I don't know to what extent justice is done by all. But my fear is that this scenario may change in time to come. Answerability of teachers will increase. I believe that in some universities, they have started fingerprints for the teacher, for the class, as well as for the day. That means there's an attendance for the teacher for the day, and also for each class. So this means the accountability will increase. So those who want to become teacher should become teacher. Then translator, interpreter, and facilitator, and specialist. Facilitator means that you do the coordination. For example, you are working in a company where you are a bridge between the two sides, Japanese and Indian. You are probably writing mails, reading mails, and translating those mails to the Indians, or vice versa. And if there is a problem, you are talking on phone and clearing that problem, but you are not solving that problem. You are a communicator. So you are a facilitator, basically. And specialist is, as I said earlier also, it could be, for example, you go into area study. You have done Japanese language, and now you want to become an expert of India-Japan relations, for example, in Asia, or India-Japan relations or India-Japan cooperation in Africa. Or you want to do research on nuclear or space or some other area. So in such cases, you can become a specialist using the language also. There's a possibility of your becoming area specialist in political science, economics, history also, the usual international studies areas. Those are also areas which are open to you. What happens in that case is that you have mastered Japanese language. Now you go into area studies and you will be reading from the primary sources. That means if you are a political science person, then you will be reading directly from the newspaper, the Japanese newspaper, on day-to-day basis. What you get in English is actually translated by somebody. Whosoever translates, it depends upon his understanding, the depth of understanding. The information which comes in English may not give that real image, but it is coming. For example, the recent new era as announced by Japan called Reiwa. The kanji Rei, if you take it from Chinese, then it means order. But they are saying it beautiful. Now this beautiful word is actually coming from Manyoshu, some literature piece, and this Rei is used for defining the beauty in a particular literary piece. Now this, if you know, if you read English and if you read the Japanese, you'll find the difference. When you read the Japanese, it comes the way I've just told you. When you read English, you can have double or triple interpretation. You will have the interpretation that they are first, for the first time they are using Japanese character and not the Chinese character. I read somewhere. It has always been a Chinese character. It has never been a Japanese character because the characters are Chinese only. The difference could be that it's picked up from Japanese literature for the first time. Picked up, you know, the concept has been picked up from Japanese literature for the first time. Now this understanding becomes very clear. It speaks of your, you know, once you understand this, then you understand that the Japanese politics or the Japanese politician and the Japanese people are working in a different level now. I believe if you, Prime Minister Abe's popularity has increased by some percentage because of announcement of Reiwa. So it connects to the heart of the people. People feel, oh, he is a Japanese. He thinks about us. He is using the word. Like this, it has impact over there. So if you read the English translation or something written in English, there will be a element of understanding as understood by the person who is writing this. And if you read the Japanese, then you are reading exactly what the Japanese mean. It gives a huge difference if you become a specialist. With this background, now let me go to the Japanese relationship. Before I talk here, I said a while ago, I think, ma'am, it should be true for all the languages if I say that no language expert in India will be without job if you have reached a particular level of that language. You know, in Japanese language we have N2, N1 type of thing, and anyone who is N2 is not jobless in India. Actually, N2 is able to choose the job also. It's only N3 that they have to probably go for a job of not maybe of their choice, but N2 can be selective also. This means if you are N1, what will happen? If you're N1, obviously you will have many options. This I believe is true for, because I had in my previous course students from French, Russian and Chinese, and I could see all the cases. If they go slightly above the level, if you are above average, then you get the job. So this means job opportunities are there. Through this presentation, I'll try to explain to you what is India-Japan relationship and how many opportunities you can probably visualize for Japanese language speakers in time to come. The relationship starts with Buddhism. It could be prior to that. And one area of study could be that did we start India-Japan relationship with Buddhism only, or there were some other interactions before that or not. For example, the rope culture is there in Okinawa. Jaggery, the good culture is there in Okinawa. And it is same as what is there in our southern states. Okinawa and southern states are quite close to each other, which means that there must be some exchanges in those days. And those exchanges could be 500 years or maybe 1,000 years or maybe 2,000 years prior to Buddhism. Nara Todaichi Temple, 752. Bodhisena performed the eye-opening of the great Buddha. A lot has been written about it. I did some study on this, did some translation on this, went to this Todaichi many times. It will not be an exaggeration to say very clearly that it is actually Japanese Buddhism, which you can see there. It is not Indian Buddhism. And Indian Buddhism cannot be absorbed in one go through Bodhisena. You understand what I mean to say? There must have been many, many interactions till then or during that period. What we see today is Bodhisena and the facts connected with Bodhisena. There is a possibility that Bodhisena was used because there was an epidemic at that point of time in Japan, in that area. This is actually Nara, so Nara, Kyoto, that area. The capital was in that area in those days. And to use religion to overcome the epidemic fear or the epidemic hysteria could have been one reason. So this could be an area of study, those who want to study the Indo-Japan relations in the past. Then Hoko and silk in Tokyo. Hoko is the Rath. You have Jagannath Rath Yatra. It's the same concept. We have huge roads, so our Rath is wide. Japan has narrow roads, so their Rath is very narrow. Instead it becomes tall. There is silk paintings decorated on the Raths. It's a two-story or three-story type of Rath. And these silk works have gone from India without doubt. Which means the silk also went there. And what we see the trading houses today of Japan, all those trading houses have their beginning in Kyoto. And this festival called Gion Matsuri, Gion Festival, happens in Kyoto. And there is a street which has got all Raths displayed there during Gion Matsuri. So there's a huge connect found there. So there's huge scope for you to study. And this can be studied only through Japanese language. It's not possible because English literature is not available. Meiji era, Indian cotton stimulated textile industry. This will come in the articles. You will see in the articles that there was a lot of impact on Japanese industry. It got stimulated because cotton went from here to Japan. Cotton is of course one raw material. It's not the finished product. It's just one raw material which went there. But many people must have got employment. Cloth or the thread is produced. From thread, cloth is produced. So there's huge employment generated. So there must have been some galvanization of Japanese industry. It comes like this. Beyond that is not known. So huge scope for study. Around 1910, Rabindranath Tagore and Okakura. This is very recent, 1910. Still, if you read, you will find only one or two pages which are very authentic write-up, not details. Details will vary. If you see the details, you'll find one person is writing one thing and the other person writes another thing. This means if you go to Japanese literature, you'll be able to trace this literature is very recent. 1910 is not very old. Then Justice Rabindra Radha Binod Bal at Tokyo Tribunal, he was judge on international tribunal. So he was working as a neutral judge, not a representative of India there. Hmm? Of course, he's an Indian, but he's not doing the judgment or his views are not on the behest of Indian government. Hmm? What was it that worked in his mind? Was he against those who were imperialist at that point of time? Was in favor of Japan or was he neutral? I'm not able to trace a paper which is very authentic on that. Huge scope of research. So I've spoken of 2000 year back, prior to that, and even 1948. So it's a huge scope of study. 51, Prime Minister Nehru's farsighted, we call it far-sighted approach. There were two things done. Elephant called Indira given to zoo, Ueno Zoo, and on the back, this is not known to many, refused to attend the San Francisco Peace Conference from a broader perspective. This was against Japan or Japan-related countries. India refused to participate. 52, at the time of establishing official diplomatic relations, India waived all the reparations claims against Japan. India was not a rich country. India had many troubles. 47, we had partition. Japan had, Pakistan had to be paid some money. Our people had shifted from one place to the other. There were two migrations taking place, one from Bangladesh side later on and one from Pakistan, then the new Pakistan to India. There was huge money required. At that point of time, when developed countries were claiming money, India refused, or India said, we want to waive off. This is a very big, far-sighted approach taken at that point of time. But there is a huge scope of, do you think, what was the thinking of government at that point of time? I have no documents to prove that. So if you go and see the Japanese documents and Indian documents, you'll find some facts which are related, and there could be many theses which can come out of this. Indian iron ore supply to Japan supported the steel industry of Japan. Up to 30% of import amount from India in 1960. And when I worked for steel industry in 1970s, I noticed that the steel which is manufactured by Japan using our ore brought back to India is cheaper than the steel produced in India. This actually proves my anxiety to learn or know about Japan. There's something different. Our ore going from India to Japan, that means transport cost, handling cost, management cost, profit. Then it is manufactured there and brought back to India, again cost, and it is cheaper. Do you know, the status remains same today also. Even today also, they are able to produce the steel at a very competitive cost. So there is something you can probably try to understand on the industry. How does the Japanese mind or Japanese people work to maintain this competitiveness? People say Japan is very costly. Their salaries are very high. So the manpower cost is high. Does it give an indication that the manpower cost is high, per person cost is high, but the efficiency per person is too high? That means a work which is done by, say, for example, 10 persons, in Japan, it could be probably done by, say, 4 people or 5 people or maybe 6 people. 2011, 46-member team of NDRF went to Japan and helped in search and rescue operations in Onagawa town, Miyagi prefecture. This was great East Japan earthquake. Now, these are the things which Japanese remember, whether it is Justice Paul, whether it is Rabindranath Tagore, whether it is elephant, whether it is reparation claims waving off, or whether helping 46 people only must have done very little work, because you need thousands of people to do rescue. So 46 people can contribute only to that extent, to this number only. But these are the facts which are remembered by the Japanese society. looking at the relations, 52 we established the official diplomatic relations, 58 Japan's first ODA loan in the world extended to India. Today it is the largest, India is the largest ODA recipient of Japan. India-Japan global partnership started in 2000. This was Prime Minister Mori visited India. I still remember there were not many people in those days who understood how to deal with Japan in India. Similarly, on Japanese side, there were not many people who understood how to deal with India. Our languages are different, our style of working is different, our understanding is different. I still remember those days when I was involved in interpretation, that there was a sense of confusion, there was a sense of uncertainty. That has changed, I'll explain how, during this period. 2005, Prime Minister Koizumi visits, and the annual summits which you see today started from then onwards. Though the relationship of annual summit started in 2000, from 2000 to 2004, there was no visit. So it's only in 2005 that it gets annualized. And 2006, India-Japan strategic and global partnership. Even in 2000, we called it global partnership, India-Japan global partnership. What it means is that India and Japan partnership, not for each other. The partnership is global. It encompasses, it's beyond two, you know, activities within these two countries. And then this changes to strategic and global partnership. Strategic means that though it is global, it is not economic only. There's a strategic element into this. 2014, the recent one with the current Prime Minister. PM Modi visits Japan, and this relationship is termed as India-Japan Special Strategic and Global Partnership. Many people have asked me, what does it mean by global partnership? What does it mean by strategic and global partnership? And what does it mean by special strategic and global partnership? As a language expert, I find it difficult to translate. So I will have to say, global was grober, partnership is partnership, and strategic becomes senryaku. So senryaku teki grober partnership, and very simple for me to say, tokubetsuna senryaku teki grober partnership. Now somebody says, what's special? And as I explained in the class, there is special something about me, then I may be exaggerating that. I have to check with others. What is, I call something special within me. But that special is my evaluation. It has to be evaluated by others. Today, people call it special relationship. What I said in 2000, the difference was there was a sense of uncertainty. Not very sure how the things will move, how they are thinking, how we should host, what type of food should be served, what language should be used. Even ministry was not sure whether I can deliver an interpretation or not. They were testing me actually at that point of time. Today, if you see further, you'll find that 2014, what happened? FDI in India within 5 years to double. We are not talking of 10% or 20% increase, we are saying double it. Double is huge. You know, doubling, for example, your salary. Today, for example, if it is 5 lakh package, increment 10%, 7%. We were talking about what is called the BPOs. So BPOs pay a lot of money in the beginning to attract you. Then they have got all the elements built into the package. For example, if you are served coffee cost is there in the package itself. Your transportation cost is there only. The bearer who serves you tea or coffee with the neat and clean clothes, his washing allowance is actually covered in the salary which you get. So all these expenses are built into the package, what they call CTC. And then the companies which pay you more, they don't give you increment more every year. They will give you 3%, 4%, 5%. There could be another company which starts with a small salary, 3 lakh package, but gives you a hike. So there has to be a realistic thing. The realistic thing, if your salary package is 5 lakh, making it 10 lakh is not so realistic. If your salary is 1 lakh, then making double is possible, 2 lakh. Because you were to be paid 3 lakh, you were paid 1 lakh, now it is doubled to 2 lakh, next year, even if it is doubled, it becomes 4 lakh. And if it you started with 3 lakh, you would have come to 4 lakh only. So it makes calculation sense. Here, it is to be doubled in 5 years. Then doubling the number of Japanese companies in 5 years, this is very tough. Bringing more companies from Japan to India, a private sector does not move on the government's orders. They will have to do the feasibility study. They will have to find whether the business suits them or not. And they do, Japanese companies are very particular about, they do a lot of study before entering into any economy. Doubling that number and the total investment in 5 years, public and private put together, is 3.5 trillion Japanese yen. This public and private means ODA, for example, the Mumbai-Ahmedabad high-speed rail, and also the private sector investment. This is going as per schedule now. This investment has been going as per schedule. 2015, Prime Minister Abe visits India and he goes to Delhi and Varanasi, and you might have seen him doing the aarti. And a long aarti. I think it was probably not less than half an hour. It was much longer. This is something which normally is not seen in history. If you see other countries, you will not see this relationship. This is what is the special relationship. It speaks of the intention of the both sides. This by itself may not have that substance. By the act itself may not have that substance, but the act has got substance behind it. Then PM Modi visits Japan and goes to Tokyo and Hyogo Prefecture. Here also Prime Minister hosted a special dinner in a house which is used for special functions. And 2017, Prime Minister Abe comes to India, and from airport to Gandhinagar, he travels in an open jeep, which is unprecedented by Japanese standards or Japanese way of doing the things. Prime Minister is not allowed to travel in open jeep, particularly in an area which is not known to him. But he agreed to travel. This shows again the relationship, and outcome here was the high-speed rail and JIM, JIM. It is Japan India Institute of Manufacturing. Small beginning, five such institutes are working here. These are the Japanese language and Japanese work methodology training institutes within the companies, within the industry or manufacturing industry to be very specific. In broader sense, we say now that the relationship is now based on shared values of democracy, humanism, and respect for rule of law. These terms I'm mentioning deliberately here, they have substance. For example, the country with which we are dealing is not short-term relationship. There is some base behind this, and that base is that the two countries are democracy. The two countries believe in humanism. The two countries, humanism will cover many things, equality, gender equality, caste, class, all those things will be covered in this. Then respect for rule of law. Rule of law means you will not go to another country to make money out of that country. You'll go to that country to partner that country, to work in a win-win situation and follow all the rules that are required. There are rules related with sea, there are rules related with air, all those rules are to be followed. Then most significant foreign policy priorities of Government of India, we mention it now. Japan, if we say that Japan is saying so, everybody listens carefully. And if Japan asks us something or there is some request from Japan, it is taken seriously to that level. Possibly one of the major success stories in contemporary times of our international engagements, and mutually beneficial to each other. Natural partner in India's transformational journey. You might have seen India, it's the other partner country cannot do, complete change for you, or cannot bring in complete change in your country. The change has to happen from within. So other country becomes a partner, and in this case, Japan is a natural partner. Transformational, you understand? Transformational means that we, till few years back, had cooking by chulas in villages. Today it is by gas. Drinking water supply to houses, households, to how many and to how many now. Electricity supply. These are the things which are transformational. These changes cannot come so easily. if you have a train which travels at a speed of 50 or 60 kilometers, going for a 300 kilometer speed train, you need to have a change in mindset. Growing synergy between Japan and India, Japan's technology plus capital, and India's economic opportunities and human resources. This has been said for very long, but these were the words in the speeches. Today, they are very substantive. We are talking in terms of the other things which will come, I'll cover there, but high-tech collaborations, potential to enable India to achieve its aspirations now. This is the slogan, new slogan, now people have enough to eat, people have space to live, but the aspirations are not yet achieved. The aspirations are pretty high. So here, it could be helpful. Then, strong summit-level engagement, greater salience in terms of significance and substance. People at different ministries work very hard. We are the coordinating ministry. We try to, every year before the summit meeting, we put extra efforts to make the meeting more substantive and put substance into it. Then, convergence of strategic interests and better appreciation of each other's concern. Concern could be, you know, we have a neighbor, they also have a neighbor, and their neighborly relationships are having issues. How much we appreciate their issues and how much they appreciate our issues. This is a very difficult thing. You know, for example, if my neighbor troubles me, I have a house and my neighbor throws garbage every day in the morning in front of my house, say at 5 o'clock in the morning. So I fight. There is a parking problem. There could be water leakage problem from the neighborhood. So there are various problems. I am troubled, but if I speak the same thing to a person who is my friend, but third or fourth house from my house, do you think the pinch will be same? No. So neighbor's pain is understood by neighbor only. It's very difficult for a far-off friend to understand the same pain with the same intensity. It is this where the concern as well as the pain is understood or appreciated more now. Broader convergence, Indo-Pacific vision, ACTIS policy is India's ACTIS policy. It used to be look east policy first. Our foreign policy has been consistent irrespective of the governments. Earlier it was look east policy, which means that we should look towards east also and not always west, that is America or west. We started looking west, then it became ACTIS policy. ACTIS policy means we should do something together or for them or with others in that area. And we also have Sagar. Sagar is security and growth for all in the region. Security in various ways, that is safety as well as what you call piracy, maybe terrorist attacks, etc. And then growth, economic growth as well as other growth for all in the region. That means growth for all together, not one country only grows. This is India's policy and FOIP is the Japanese policy. It used to be FOIPS first, Free and Open Indo-Pacific Strategy. Strategy word was not liked or was not appreciated much, so it has been dropped. So it's a Free and Open Indo-Pacific thinking or policy. The two matches, the defense partnership, military to military exercises and exchanges, and defense technology cooperation. These are the areas where the first one is moving very positively. The second one is defense technology cooperation, because the defense technology in Japan is handled by private sector. Government is the guiding force or the clearing authority, but the private sector has to move. On Indian side, the privatization has just started. It's not, it will take shape in time to come. So starting up this cooperation at this stage probably will increase our cooperation in time to come. Japan today is a contributor to Make in India, Skill India, Digital India, Startup India, etc. We'll just Make in India, I just said that there is cooperation happening in the manufacturing sector. I don't know in this area, but the big names you know are Suzuki, Toyota, the automobile industry, electronic industry. There are technology coming from Japan, so it's Make in India happening there. Skill India is where they are training our people. And Digital India is helping in the digital domain. In this case, it is going to be mutual. We are also we also have a lot of excellence in the field of digital. Startup India is has actually taken, it has been accelerated last year. 60 companies committed a particular amount of money or a fund. It's called Fund of Funds. There are various funds and it's called Fund of Funds to support the startups in India, particularly in IT industry. PM Visit 2018, this was the 13th India-Japan Annual Summit with Japanese Prime Minister. And this was the PM Modi's 5th Annual Summit. That means in 5 years, five visits or five meetings, not visits. And 12th meeting since 2014. This speaks something. 5 years and 12 meetings. That means though the annual summit is taking place once in a year, but the total number of meetings is more than two per year. This year also the Prime Minister will meet two times probably. Closer personal relationship, Prime Minister Abe hosted Prime Minister Modi in his personal countryside villa in Yamanashi. This was the first ever such occasion. And it's actually eating food together. It doesn't mean much. You know, eating food together does not really mean much. But what happens is that when you go to personal villa, the food is 1:1. That means only two prime ministers are there and two interpreters. No one else is there. So they only eat and keep talking and interpreters only talk. So there's a huge amount of communication taking place. And over this dinner, you can talk, because there are nothing recorded. Records are maintained, of course, but it can be informal discussion. So there is it speaks of the chemistry basically. And if there are issues which are not completed there, you know, when we eat and talk, you say, okay, let's discuss this further. And this discussion further takes place in the train thereafter. Because there is something left, so they board the same train, sit next to each other, and the discussion takes place there also. This was for the first time that the total duration of the two prime ministers being together was approximately 8 hours, which is not normal. Normally, it is approximately 2 to 3 hours. And outcome was 30 documents concluded, which included vision statement, 12 fact sheets, and this vision statement is a change from joint statement to vision statement. Joint statement is that two prime ministers of two countries make a statement which is a jointly made, which is agreed by the both sides. And it is made every year. So there is a change in the joint statement. Vision statement means this is our vision for the next few years. So this statement becomes vision for next 3 to 5 years. This means it's more fundamental, basic, broad-based, and fact sheets take care of the specific cooperations under this collaboration. Some of the examples, one was currency swap arrangement. These are the terms I am including here for the language students, that these are the terms that you require to remember if you need to do interpretation in political arena. Currency, swap, and then arrangement. So these are three different words, three different terms are there. US 75 billion, that means conversion of the currency, because if you have to interpret this into English, if you say 75 billion US is fine for India, but if you say the same for Japan, it's much better to say it in Japanese yen. This means you will have to convert this figure into Japanese yen and then speak, and then billion also has to be converted into Japanese. Billion has got 9 zeros, so you'll have to go for man, that means, you understand? It will be oku plus 1, 8 zeros plus 1. So that conversion has to take place in your mind if you are doing interpretation. Then 60 Japanese companies, I just said, have committed US $3 billion of investment. Digital partnership, I said, new direction set. New era technologies like artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, then big data, innovation, cyber infrastructure, etc. These are the areas in which discussions are not now going on between India and Japan. And these are of great significance to both Japan, India, as well as to the world. Because if you have, for example, 5G, 5G will be very fast. What it means is that your data, which could be privacy data, for example, your facial recognition system through retina, eyes, if this database is available to somebody, you can be easily tracked. You know, cameras can be put all over the city. If you are captured once, It will always tell that you are moving towards south, north, etc. The other camera will track you, so your movement can be tracked. So there are issues related in 5G and artificial intelligence. Therefore, it's necessary now that the standards are made at international level and which are followed by all the countries. So collaboration and cooperation is possible in this area, which would mean that if you want to go into this area, you must know the terminology of the software industry. Not only software industry, of the state-of-art technologies like artificial intelligence or Internet of Things. Then space dialogue, it has been just launched. The first dialogue has already taken place. Space dialogue has got two, three elements. One is that you remember that we have hit one of our satellites for testing, for experimental purposes. This means that there will be debris in the space. This debris has to be managed in time to come. This is one area where the cooperation is required or is possible. There could be joint missions, for example, joint lunar mission, etc., which could take place. So there could be management or space management areas. There could be strategic or defense related cooperation, or there could be joint missions between India and Japan. Japan recently joined ISA, International Solar Alliance. It has just begun. France and India took the initiative to start this International Solar Alliance. What it means is that you tap the solar energy wherever you can tap more. So the countries like India, the countries where the sun is available all through the year, you must tap this energy and convert this energy into the reusable, maybe electrical or some other energy, which will save on other natural resources. And Japan agreed to be the member, which will give an edge with regard to, you know, in terms of technology which they can support us with. Healthcare is one area where we have been using Japanese technology, like for example the syringe, butterfly, it comes from Japan. There are many such small instruments which come from Japan, the equipment, the x-ray machines, etc., which come from Japan. We are seeking a bigger cooperation. India has started Ayushman, which means try to give health or take care of the health of the individual so that healthcare is not required. Healthcare means post-sickness care is not required. Similarly, Japan is going for AVIN. This is Asia Health Related Network of Japan, where they are also targeting a society where people don't fall ill. So it's a healthy, longer life. We are trying to find the synergy between the two and see wherever cooperation is possible. It could be in the area of yoga going from here to Japan, Ayurveda going from here to Japan, which are more user-friendly or human-friendly treatments. And there could be areas where we learn from Japan, the SOPs or the methods. Then Indian traditional medicine, I've just mentioned. Ayush and Kanagawa Prefecture have signed an MOC. MOC is Memorandum of Cooperation. There are other MOCs expected. Ayush is actually Ministry of Ayush. It's a ministry, takes care of traditional knowledge, including Ayurveda. India-Japan relationship has got an element called strategic element, and I was just trying to tell you that if people ask me what does strategic mean, this is all what strategic means. So if you have to understand strategic, then you see what needs to be understood. So it's institutionalized, ministerial level, 2+2. So you must understand 2+2. So 2+2 actually is two ministers from each side meeting together. In Japanese also, it's called 2+2. So if you understand that when the Japanese is saying 2+2, it either means secretary level 2+2 or it could mean minister level 2+2. And suppose you have a minister level meeting where the defense minister and foreign minister, Indian, meeting Japanese defense minister and foreign minister together, four meeting together. So you know how the communication will go. Suppose the Japanese defense minister and Indian one minister do not know the English language. Then it will become Hindi, English, Japanese. It has to be simultaneously done. To be done simultaneously for all the speakers. Because one is speaking in Hindi, it will go into English, whereas the Japanese minister will understand only Japanese. So it has to be translated into English first and from English to Japanese simultaneously. for you, this is one. Then institutionalizing or institutionalized is another word which needs to be understood. So for you, first understanding what does institutionalizing mean, the word itself, and then the translation. You will find that you will have to understand this word first, then you can translate it. So what I said a while ago in the class, that these are the terms, the words, kanji and the terms are not difficult. You should leave them aside. Master first the structure capturing and structure transfer. First thing. Once you have done that, then the dictionary helps you getting these words, and dictionary does not help in getting the words like institutionalizing. Try to search the word institutionalizing, even in English. You'll find it difficult to understand. And the word is available now, of course. Then commencement of negotiations on EXA. EXA is actually acquisition and cross-servicing agreement. Acquisition means acquire. Cross-service means from here to there, cross-servicing. So it's actually Navy, two Navy doing service to each other. It's under discussion. We are having the meeting tomorrow actually, day after tomorrow. Then implementation arrangement for deeper cooperation between the two navies. Cooperation is already going on. This is the deeper cooperation. Deeper means it has got strategic elements and it has got broader elements which were there already. Some detailing is being done. Then trilateral Malabar already happening. It's US, India and Japan joined. Then first ever bilateral armies. Exercise called Dharam Guardian, conducted from 1st to 14th November 2018. It's conducted in 2018 only. That means the terms which are used here, for example, this term, you understand? It's a Hindi term. So it has to be translated. It cannot be available in Japanese. No? First bilateral air exercise, Shinyu Maitri. Shinyu also is Maitri. The Shinyu word also is Maitri. So if you are supposed to translate this, it will become a headache. Maitri means Shinyu. And it's called Shinyu Maitri. So if you translate, you will have to do the ambiguous translation. I did not talk about this a while ago. When there are two terms and the two mean same, you have to retain the two, otherwise the user will say one term you have eaten away. So you will have to bring in two terms which will have same connotation type of thing. Then these are some of the specifics of economics. MAHSR is Mumbai Ahmedabad High Speed Rail. DMIC is Delhi Mumbai Industrial Corridor. DFC is Delhi Mumbai again Freight Corridor. Metro, you know, there is one metro which was Delhi Metro made earlier, and now there are five being made. TITP is very important for you to understand. It's called Technical Internship Training Program. This has started very recently, about 3 years back. It took a lot of time to discuss with Japan to convince our side. What it means is that you export your labor from here to Japan. It was done under a platform called JITCO. And now it's called TITP. And TITP is a more institutionalized or a well-structured program of Japan. There could be cases of exploitation. Under JITCO, there were complaints that the exploitation of the people who were going from India to Japan was done. So when, not from India, but from other countries to Japan, it was found that some of the complaints were correct. Though everything was not correct, but some complaints were correct. The Japanese government intervened and started supervising it, monitoring it through this program called TITP. And we agreed to send our people from here to Japan under this program. This data is slightly old. 17 persons from South had gone already and are working in Japan with very high reputation. They know Japanese language. They have learned Japanese language here in India. And now they are speaking in Japanese language and doing the work there. And we have got very positive feedback about these 17. I think 5 or 6 male nurses are going to Japan probably this week. Now, so this number is probably going to increase to a 3-digit number in about a year or so from now. And once it goes to say 100, after that, there are about 29 or 23 agencies which have been identified who are training Indian labor force to go to Japan. And recently Japan has changed, has passed another law which provides for long-term visa of two categories. One is a 3-year visa and the other is unending visa for professionals. So there are two categories. Now people can go to Japan and work for 3 years which is something like TITP, and there is a professional visa, which is for long term. People can go from India and work there for forever. Even for 3-year visa also, people can continue to work after 3 years depending upon your performance. If your employer likes you, then you can continue to work. So there could be, I was saying that you should pick up a job or a profession which you like or which you are happy with. So there could be a possibility of some of you going to Japan under this program. It could be the professional one, or it could be the other one also. Or you could be an instrument in sending people from India to Japan. You can train people here. You can train, you can go to a village, pick up good people from there, train them in Japanese language, and train them in some skill, and send them these people to Japan. Japanese is very good in training or further training our people. So they will further train while on job, these people, and working in Japan is quite comfortable. It's long working. Long working means standing and doing work in the industry for 8 hours is normal practice. But people are used to it. It's done in a very nice way with small breaks in between for lunch and tea, etc. And there is no case of physical problem coming out of 8 hours standing and doing the job. And Japanese people also do the same way. Then ACTIS forum, I have just spoken about ACTIS policy. ACTIS forum is a agreement signed between India and Japan, which our ministry, that Ministry of External Affairs, is responsible on Indian side. It's basically to work on joint projects in the northeast area of India. It could be road connectivity, it could be other connectivity, it could be infrastructure project, it could be living standard upgradation projects. India-Japan cooperation in the Indo-Pacific is another cooperation which is done by Ministry of External Affairs only, not by my division, but the division which are responsible for Asia. In Asia, there are various countries handled by different divisions. For example, Sri Lanka, Maldives is handled by one division. Bangladesh, Myanmar is handled by another division. Africa is also handled by few divisions. So the divisions which under which those countries fall, they are responsible for this cooperation from Indian side. We are currently trying to work out a project in Kenya, a cancer hospital, where Indian side will probably construct the hospital and Japanese side will provide the equipment, and Indian side will provide training on for the doctors and the paramedical staff. About MAHSR, this is one project which I don't deal directly. The MEA does not deal directly, but MEA negotiated this project and guided this project in the beginning, and now we remain involved in this project. And this is a 500 plus kilometer length. Total investment is 10,800 crore rupees, out of which 88,000 crore rupees is Japanese ODA. Then Japanese ODA is coming from JICA. Japanese soft loan would fund 81%. This is what is the 88,000 crores of the project. Rate of interest is 0.1% per annum, which is quite negligible. Normally in India, the rate of interest is, if you go to bank, your normal fixed deposit or normal savings account is about 5%, 4 to 5%. Fixed deposit is 7 to 8-9% in the bank. And if you borrow money from banks, even if they say that the rate of interest is 10%, actual interest is actually more than that, 11 or 12%. Similarly here also, actual interest may be slightly more than 0.1%, but 0.1% is very low interest. It's almost negligible. Yes, it becomes actually lower, yeah. Then repayment period is 50 years. So you pay in such short period, and moratorium is 15 years. This means 15 years grace period can be given. Target December 2023 and trial run by 2022 August. Training center has already been built. It will start functioning next year or probably this year only. Western dedicated freight corridor, I won't discuss much. It is basically to give a dedicated freight corridor for the freight running, so that this line, the normal passenger line, becomes free of freight corridor. So normal passenger trains will run at a speed of 100 or 100 plus, because if the goods train run on the same track, the other trains get late. So this will be helpful to us in that sense also. And the speed of the dedicated freight corridor will be much more than the current speed. DMIC's industrial corridors, there are 8 hubs on the sides of this freight corridor where industrial sectors are being developed. Okay, let me speak on this. This is my area, so I'm happy that after going to ME, this happened and I could push certain things out of this particular activity. It's an activity which is signed by the secretary in our ministry and the Japanese ambassador of from the embassy of Japan. It's the activity is run by me and the minister in the embassy together. We have a target of training 1,000 Japanese language teachers in a period of 5 years. Total number which have been trained so far is about 120. There is new courses to be started at 100 Japanese. It could be existing centers or it could be new centers. Now this gives you a hint that what is in store for all of you. So there will be competition, of course. More students will be learning Japanese language. But trust me, when the competition is there, you will perform much better. Current status, I have already told, about 170, I said 170 have been trained, and one 360 hour course has been completed. Will be completed on 12th, day after tomorrow. You know, if you see this relationship between India and Japan, there is a vision now, and there are values added, and there is a convergence, and the complementarity. This is the base of the relationship of India and Japan, and what it gives is the global and regional peace, stability and prosperity. Now, if you have to understand that what is in store for you for next 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years, this speaks of this. If it's an economic relationship, then what happens after MAHSR? High speed rail is built, it is running, so the interpreter is not required. But the relationship is not restricted to MAHSR, relationship is based on this. So this will continue for decades together. This is, I've already talked about it. These are the 12 fact sheets which have been signed between India and Japan. Now this covers most of the activities, including the Japanese language promotion activity which I've spoken. First one is development cooperation in Indo-Pacific, that is in Asia and Africa together. Together with Japan. ACTIS Forum is in our Northeast area, our activity in our Northeast. India has recently in last few years put more focus on Northeast. Lot of investment has been done, lot of things have been streamlined, infrastructure has been built. Its connectivity to the other states is being worked out. There we are seeking Japan's help and Japan is more than willing to participate in this. Then India-Japan Economic and ODA Cooperation, I have already talked, MAHSR, DMIC, not DMIC, there are some cooperations where it is happening. And then Make in India skill development, most of the things I have talked, agriculture, food processing, food safety, forestry and fisheries, another area. This speaks of the industries where you will be able to find employment. Then security defense have been covered. Disaster risk reduction is another area. Japan has got huge experience of managing the disaster, actually forecasting the disasters. Forecasting and trying to do the prevention also, at least saving on the casualties. So here we are seeking their help, and science and technology includes both space, nuclear and other areas. Thank you so much for my long talk, for being patient. I think time is less, but I would like to take as many questions as possible.
Can I have a round of applause for Professor Chawla? So we'll move into the Q&A. We have distributed papers to you. So if you have the questions, if you want anonymous questions, you can write your questions and give it to Vamshi Sensei over here. So we'll take about 5 minutes break till they write the question, and then I'll. Yeah. If there's any question that you would want to ask right now, you are free to do so. Please raise your hand, and I'll get the mic to you. Sensei, you can.
Two things I would like to know from you for clarification. One is One is regarding the training centers. Like you said, they're going to be set up. Where? Maybe at the connection I missed, perhaps. So, the second one is new Japanese language courses. So are you referring to new centers where Japanese is taught, or new courses as such are going to be designed to train especially translators and interpreters?
I should have spoken it in more details, but I rushed through the last slides because of time. It's a very confused you know, type of expression here. Japanese language is being taught already in many universities. What we are getting is not matching the industry's need. So industry has been asking for more translators, more interpreters, more people who can facilitate their cooperation or their working. So we need more people who can read and write Japanese, and this can happen only if there are new schools, new colleges where Japanese is introduced. So this 100 actually includes existing colleges and new institutes also. New institutes we believe could be one or two or five UGC based also, but mostly it will be in the private sector. So it will be private institutes where and they need teachers, so we are training teachers, and the 1,000 teachers actually targets that. So these teachers will be available for teaching. And suppose a company employs a person as a translator or interpreter. This person translates or interprets, for example, half of the day. Rest of the time he can teach there itself to the scientists or to the engineers or to the staff of that particular company. This is the target. And with regard to translator interpreters, this particular MOU does not target that. I have a dream, if possible, to start a, you know, once I get free from my assignment, then definitely I'll try to do a translation interpretation institute. And my target would be, of course, that nobody should go abroad to learn interpretation. We are sending people now to America to become an interpreter in Chinese or in Japanese even. So there's no need. We have got expertise here available. It's only organizing that expertise. There is one institute already in the South which trains translators, but more efforts are required. I would request universities to do the needful, and we'll be able to do something, maybe some cooperation to the extent possible to facilitate that.
Offering courses in Japanese for a long time, the last 25 years, that's what we said. In the period of 25 years, I don't know how many people have taken this seriously. And how many interpreters and translators of merit we could produce. Maybe you can help the center to redesign, relook at this syllabus, and some of the students also, see, most of them may not end up teaching Japanese. They might get jobs as translators and interpreters, or they might work for industry doing translation or interpretation.
You know, I agree, because it's more paying, and it's very difficult to retain a student to be a teacher when there is no surety or guarantee that he or she will get the job, number one, and number two, if the salary paid outside is double or more than what is offered here, then it depends. That's what I try to talk to students, that try to do only what you feel that you will be happy with. So if you decide that you want to be a teacher, then you decide and be in that area. And if you want to become a translator or interpreter, then focus on that, check it and recheck it. And if you think that you are able to do that, then definitely do this. What I was told by my teacher, there's a teacher called S.K. Chaudhary, that every 5 years only you'll find one person. Now, I don't want to be very pessimistic, but I would like to turn it to five per year at least. If you have excellent translator and excellent interpreter coming out, five excellent translator and excellent interpreters every five every year, I believe that they'll be able to pull another 50 with them. You know, there's a, when they go into the field and work, it becomes a stimulus for others to try the same.
Right.
That's the one way. And all your Japanese faculty, they're very well known to me. So I'll be more than happy to guide in, you know, shaping the curriculum if need be at any point of time.
Thank you.
Actually, I wanted to add one small thing. Madam had asked like about translator into interpreter. But I mean, like, we can maybe grade the translator into three categories, because since we have been into that interpretation field, one is a normal shop floor interpreter. The other one being like, you know, maybe technical collaborations between in the board of the company board meetings, or like, you know, collaborations between companies, or like maybe sales negotiations, technical specifications and all that stuff. But there's another level, like, we know we are talking about the government, and where, like, you know, the kind of interpretation you do, it's not only about the Japanese skills itself, it's about also, like, you know, whether a person is suited to, you know, take that pressure. So mental training is needed. Then the flow of language, like, I stammer, so I'll be a big failure there. Even though I can interpret, I know everything, but I have this habit of stammering and speaking too fast. So that I'll be a failure there. So I mean, I think that level of interpretation training is like a very different ballgame altogether.
You know, in interpretation overseas, there are two categories basically, and the categories are called simultaneous and simultaneous, or sometimes they call it conference interpreters. And there is other one is one-to-one. So you can say probably three categories: one-on-one, which is industrial, basic industrial, and then conference interpretation, which is not simultaneous, it's consecutive, but happening in a conference way, and the other one is simultaneous. It's probably closer to the conference interpretation, what you're saying. So this may not be, it may not be easy to categorize it as one category, but in Japan they do it by grading, you know, A grade, B grade, C grade type of thing. So the lowermost can be industry, higher goes for normal company interpretations of meetings, and the much higher can go probably for the strategic type of meetings, you know.
I have a question from the audience here. So the first question, there are three questions. So the first one is, I'll paraphrase. So if one wants to go and follow your career, let's say from a Japanese language expert and move into the your present position where you handle diplomatic relations, what would be the best way? What is the process? How do you get from where they are?
Yeah, I expected this question. Yeah. Let me be very frank to you. I am the first person who entered laterally into Ministry of External Affairs at Joint Secretary level. It may not be so easy for many to follow, because there are certain conditions that are required. If you are entering laterally, at a lateral entry, you need to have a qualification that is required for that particular post. So you must be in the same level outside. So only the professors in the university who are already professor, or who are scientists, for example, I was working in a S&T body. There could be DRDO, there could be cabinet secretariat. These are the areas where you reach up to director level. Director level, you understand? There is, in Government of India, there is Undersecretary, Deputy Secretary, Director, then Joint Secretary, then Additional Secretary, and then Secretary. This is the hierarchy. And if you are Director level, then you can probably become eligible to apply for lateral entry. Lateral entry may not be so easy, because the systems are very rigid. You have to suit other requirements also. In my case, I have been doing the interpretation from 2000 onwards for the ministry. So I'm in touch with the ministry on very regular basis for approximately 20 years, and they knew me, I knew them, and it was a type of thing that you must come now, and then you have, one has to see that whether I fit or doesn't fit, because, you know, if I have the qualification, if I don't have the qualification, I go at a level which is lower than what I would like to go into. But there is another channel which is a language cadre. I did not talk about it. Ministry of External Affairs has got a language cadre where the individuals enter not through IFS. They enter through the language. Now, there's a post is advertised, and this post, you apply for the post. There is a written exam, then there is an interview conducted, and then you go and join somewhere as an attache below the undersecretary level. So from attache onward, you can go up, and I can just tell you that there is one person who has become ambassador also, who had gone through this cadre. The persons who interpret now for the Prime Minister very often is expected to go to Joint Secretary level. this is not lateral entry, it's entry from the bottom but going up the ladder. Now this is, you know, the students should understand that even if you join a university, then you are a probationer first, then you are a lecturer, then you become a reader. It's called assistant professor or associate professor and then professor. A number of years have to be put, a number of conditions have to be met, like papers to be published, PhD, etc. So those are the conditions which you have to meet to go up in the cadre. Similarly, there is a requirement in the ministries also. Normally, IAS, IFS, they go through the IAS, IFS exam only. The lateral entry or the entry other than the IAS, IFS is a limited entry. So it's not very open in the sense that there are not too many posts available. But there was an advertisement for filling up one Japanese language position very recently. Interviews have been taken. I think interviews are already over. This was for Hindi to Japanese interpretation. It was for many, many languages, but there was one for the Hindi to Japanese also, which will definitely come in next few years also. So those who want to join this type of cadre, you must look for all such postings. For example, DRDO, Defense Research Development Organization, Cabinet Secretariat. There are other things also, like in Sena, in Defense Ministry, there are some posts. So look for all such posts which are available on the net and make an entry somewhere. And then when the post comes in MEA, then you try for the MEA. With you, if you have an experience of, you know, I did not talk, the time was not available. There are terms, for example, ETLA, it came here. Our collaboration of on the space side with the Japan is ETLA. It's called Acquisition Technology and Logistic Agency. There are other terms like UNCLOS. It's United Nations Convention on the Law of Sea. Like this, there are many terms, ARF, EAS. These terms should be known to you. You should understand, and not the terms alone. As it was just mentioned, that if you want to have a diplomatic career, then you must understand the concept. For example, East Asia Summit it's a summit of countries which are in the East Asia. But you will find America participating in East Asia Summit, Japan participating, India participating there. So you must understand the history behind this. So it's not very difficult. You know, these are the concepts available. These are available on Google also. You can read through the text, understand them very well. And as I said a while ago, try to see whether it interests you or not. When you read these terms, the type of work they do, the type of activities they do too, do you really find that they are interesting to you? If they are not, then it may be very painful to do interpretation. Because in interpretation, it will be giving you headache if you don't understand it.
Thank you. The second question is, again, yes, I'm taking quite a lot of freedom here. But what I think is this is with regards to what you said in the first second slide of your where you said there are different ways of approaching Japanese language education, and you mentioned that enjoy whatever you do and whatever you like. The person here wants to know is that so you have joined the industry, went back into for your MA program and then joined the industry again. So for a lot of people, there are some economic constraints that don't allow them to go back into learning. What would your advice be for those?
Okay, just one correction. I did 1 year of Japanese, then went into industry. Then I was told that your level is very bad after some time. And then I left and started education learning once again. Then I joined university first. And this university was a ad hoc post, not a regular post. So I went into the S&T, that is CSIR, Council for Scientific Industrial Research. So my longest career that is approximately 37 years. After that, I went into MEA while I was doing the MEA work also. So my industry experience, then I went to academics again, then came back to the S&T and then teaching also. Now, in my case, two times I took the risk. And the risk was really very strong because it was a huge risk. If you think that in today's world, you know, economic criteria, etc. If you have worked for 1 year, my principle is simple. If you have worked for 1 year, you were not working before that for that 1 year. This means your income before 1 year was zero, and now your income is, say, for example, 3 lakh or 5 lakh a year. So your spending should not be 5 lakh. Your spending should be 2 lakh, 1 lakh only. So you save 4 lakh or 3 lakh. So you work for 2 years, you already have 8 lakh rupees. Where is the economic compulsion now to leave and go back? Once you are going for study purposes, if your decision is correct, you know, if you have well thought of, then don't worry about the economic thing, because you will come back at least at the same level. And if not same, it will be definitely better, because you are gone, you understand the things much better then. So once you have left one job and gone into the studies and want to go back into the industry, I am very sure that will be a better position.
So can I add this? Since what I have done, see, actually,
you need not be scared, because you have a skill, language skill. Like, see, I was exactly that. I took that risk, and sir also knows. But there was one thing which always gave me confidence, that I can translate, I can interpret. And this was the time when internet was also, had just started, of course, very slow. So I could always download my work from office and then work and then send it back by the net itself. So I could always earn money while I studied. And of course, like, I was in a worse situation because I was married and my wife was expecting as well. So it became all the more difficult for me to take the decision. But I had to, because I did not want to regret later on.
Yeah, please remember, it is never risk free. There is zero risk, I can't say. And it's also possible that you may not get the same type of job or equivalent salary. But suppose you thought that you'll be more happy if you do a particular course or a particular study. Now if you come back and do the same job even at a lower salary, your happiness quotient is much higher. So you'll enjoy more. So there's no harm if you are sure that you lack something and you can gain that by going back to study. Do that, or by changing from one field to the other field.
I think since it's time and I don't want to bother you more. Thanks a lot for taking time from a busy schedule for the inaugural lecture here. Thank you. A round of applause, please.
Thank you so much. Thank you.